Hi everyone, happy Monday. It feels like it's been a while since we've been together. I think the last time I live streamed, I was at Gary's house in Maryland, and we skipped last week for the 4th of July, took the week off, so it's been a couple of weeks. So welcome, so glad that you guys are here. Back to our regular Monday schedule. Excuse me just a second. I got a little tickle in my throat. It's actually a pretty nice day here. It's been pretty warm. I think for the next week, it's supposed to heat up into the high 90s. Today we're getting into the 89 degree temperature range. So today's actually gonna be the coolest day for about a week. Here in Southern California, stay cool, stay hydrated. Make sure to take care of yourself first and then take care of your plants. But today we're gonna talk about what to do in the garden in July. Can you guys believe it's already July? I mean, summer is here in full force. We're even getting into the dog days of summer, which are the hot, long, dry days. But here in California, our hottest months are usually September, October, usually starting in August for a couple of months, we get really, really hot weather. Still plenty of hot weather to come. Nisha is saying same in Colorado. Yes, heating up all over the country. I know Connie up in Oregon was in the chat early before live stream started. I think she's still there. She said it's in the 90s in Oregon, which can happen too often. So hopefully those of you in the Pacific Northwest are staying cool. I know a lot of you don't have air conditioning. So make sure that you stay cool, stay hydrated, and just, you know, take care of yourselves. So let's say hello to those of you that are here in the chat. Looking forward to today's live. We have Rocky here, hardly no rain. Yeah, I hear you on that one for sure. No rain here. Really nice to have you here today. And she says, I was actually watching Gary's most recent video and you went live from Southern Maine. That's awesome. Glad that you were able to catch us live on there. Let's see, Charlene, perfect weather. Nicole, how's it going? Great to see you here. Of course, Nisha and Cliff are moderators here every week. My Backyard Gourds, Gina Mario, the people here, Catherine Laura, hi Kim, still in the hot weather, I sure will. Jan, Terry Williams, I know the Healing Berry is here from Germany. It's really fun to see people here from all over the world on live streams, and we just have a really good time. So if you're brand new, welcome. We do live stream most Mondays at noon Pacific time. And it's all about just kind of sharing some tips. I usually pick a topic for the day that we talk about, but we're really just here to have fun and interact and lots of garden support together. People have been live streaming here with me for about 3 or maybe going on 4 years. So people are getting to be great friends. So please come back and join us every Monday, and we just have a good time together. So usually I share a garden tip of some kind and then go into the chat to answer questions. And it's just a more casual conversation where we can get to know each other and just hang out and talk gardening. I mean, gardeners are just some of the nicest people in the world, in my very unbiased opinion. Kim here, welcome. I'm a new gardener and enjoy with you. That's awesome. I'm so glad to hear it. I love to talk to new gardeners because they're just so excited about gardening, which is super fun. Christina, I made it to a live stream. That's great. Great to have you. Luz from Southern Arizona. My daughter said we had to watch Callum. I love you, and daughter Luz. You're such an amazing support to us. We really appreciate you being here. And hello to your daughter. I hope things are going well in your garden there in Arizona, and you're staying cool in the crazy, crazy heat that everybody is experiencing. It's nuts. So let's jump into our stream topic of the day. What to do in the garden in July. So there's lots going on in the garden now. And the first thing I want to encourage everyone to do, and I'm sure as gardeners, we don't have a whole lot of encouragement to do this, is to enjoy your harvest. Get out there and start harvesting. You can see here, my tomato is just about ready to harvest, you guys. And people asking what kind of tomato it is. And unfortunately, I don't know the variety. It's crazy. When I was transplanting some of my seedlings back in the spring, I unfortunately dropped my big old tray with the packs in it. And they dropped all over the ground right over here. I was potting them, and I was really nervous, like, oh my gosh, they're all gonna break. What a bummer, all my hard work. I was able to save the seedlings, but all the tags fell out. And I do have some varieties that are marked in the garden, but a lot of my tomatoes just got mixed up this year. So it's getting kind of fun to see, like, if I figure out, number one, what I planted to begin with, and number two, look up pictures and identify the different tomato varieties that I have. I do know for sure some, like Golden Jubilees, we've already been harvesting for several weeks. Yeah, I missed your tomatoes, Philip. It'll be fun. So I do know the Golden Jubilees. We've been harvesting some ones that are in my seed collection. The name escapes me at the moment. We've been harvesting those. And of course, the Tiny Tims, where are those? Right back behind me here. I know what a lot of them look like. But this one, I think, was a new one to me. They're either that Cliff sent me or one that I, you know, had purchased, a new seed that I purchased to grow. Definitely an heirloom. It has that fun kind of heirloom shape, but not the variety. So wish me luck that I can figure it out. And we'll go from there. But do make sure you get out there and harvest your tomatoes, your peppers, your beans as they're coming on. And a lot of vegetables, the more you harvest, the more they grow. Especially beans, I've noticed, is I got to get out there just about every day to pick them. Or they don't really, you know, grow as prolifically. Or the beans get way too large and not any good for eating. So we were gone over the weekend, and I didn't get out last night to harvest, so I got to get out this evening, so it'll be too hot this afternoon, and go through all my beans and make sure I pick my beans. Get out there, enjoy your harvest. This is what we do it so that we can, you know, enjoy and grow our own food. And one of my personal garden goals for this summer is to eat during the day only out of the garden. So I don't usually eat breakfast. But after the live stream, I'll go out and pick a tomato or maybe a couple of my Tiny Tims right back here. And I only eat out of the garden during the day. And then dinner, we usually barbecue or do something like that. We might grill up some vegetables. But see what you can do to incorporate the garden fresh vegetables, fruit in every single meal. If I do have breakfast, it's usually raspberries or strawberries that I just go out in the garden and pick and pop them in my mouth and eat them while I'm outside doing my gardening in the morning. So join me on that. That's great, but it's a really healthy way to eat. Sometimes I'll pick herbs, throw that in my with my tomatoes and cucumbers. But I've really been enjoying, I feel much better, not like having a big heavy lunch. I've never been a big lunch eater, but a big heavy lunch. And then for dinner, we usually have, you know, our bigger meal. So it's been working out really, really well for me. So let me know if you have any gardens like that here in the summertime. But it's one of the fun things about having harvesting in your garden too, is if you can't eat it, you couple things with it. In other words, if you can't eat as much as you grow, which I know a lot of you have an abundance of harvests, or maybe you just grow only, you know, a little bit so you have enough to eat. Not enough to eat, but so that you can supplement what you get at the grocery store. But if you have extra, give it away. It's so much fun. If you take it over next door, or if you give it to some friends that stop by, or drop it off, you know, at some friends' houses or whatever, it's really fun. And then people just get so excited because it just tastes so amazing. We had a friend here a few weeks ago and I was making blackberries, and I gave him a couple blackberries to eat, and he about fell out of his chair. He could not believe the flavor, the size of the berries, how juicy they were. And he told me a few days later, he went to Costco to pick up some berries because he got so hungry. And he was so disappointed how much different they tasted. So I said, no worries, come over next time I have a harvest and I'll give you some more to enjoy. So it really gets people excited. The other thing you can do if you have a lot to harvest is now's a good time to start preserving your harvest. I'm not really fond of canning, and I usually don't have enough all at once to can. But if you love to do that, more power to you. I know Cliff does a ton of canning. He and his wife can a lot of what they eat during the winter in their huge garden. So if you do that, more to you. If I have extra, I tend to either give it away or I freeze it. I have a lot of freezer space, so I just pop those tomatoes in a bag, pop my extra berries in a bag, and then I can pull them out later. You know, they're nice and crisp and, you know, they're fresh because they're frozen. They're fresh frozen. They're not like slicing tomatoes or anything like that, but you can use them in recipes. So that's a really good, quick, simple, easy way to preserve your harvest if you don't want to go to the trouble of canning. So let's the chat now and hear what all you guys are harvesting and what you like to do with your extra harvest. But do make sure, I know we all get busy, but get out there and take the time, check your garden daily and harvest what you're growing. I mean, that's one of the funnest things about gardening is eating what you grow. It's so incredibly rewarding. Christina, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry to hear this. My cat ate my first heirloom tomato. That could be really disappointing. I mean, your cat's probably healthy at this point. But when you're looking forward to something like that, that's super frustrating. So hopefully you can get the next one before your cat grabs it. You can take your tomatoes off the vine a little bit early if you're having pest issues like squirrels, cats, or anything else eating them. Harvest them at first blush when they first start to turn. Take them into the house, put them not on the sunny windowsill. They'll kind of rot a little bit or a lot quicker. Don't put them in the refrigerator, but just put them on the countertop out of direct sunlight, or put them in a paper bag. If you throw in a green banana, they'll ripen a little bit quicker, or you can just set them in the paper bag and the ethylene gas will be released from the tomato and it'll ripen just a little bit quicker. So do that if you're having problems with things eating your tomatoes. Okay, let's see here. Edward, today I harvested my first peppers and tomatoes. That's super fun. That first harvest is always really, really special. And Pete Treadway, great to have you back. Hope you had a great vacay. And Patricia says, where'd your comment go? I think you saw a hornworm. Oh my gosh. So if you guys missed my Instagram reel last week, I pulled off a hornworm. I told you in that reel how you can find a hornworm. And I was that one I pulled off was actually a tobacco hornworm, not a tomato hornworm. But they do, either one, they do still chow down through your tomato plant. So keep a wary eye out for them. If you haven't seen them, go back and watch my Instagram reel. A couple tell signs, they little kind of largish droppings. So look for those. Or if you see your tomato leaves strip off all of a sudden at night, get out there and look on your plant to see if you do have a tomato hornworm, because literally they can destroy your plant overnight. I actually picked off several last night when we got home. You can do a couple of things. You can either throw them in like the green trash bin to kind of feed off the other plants in there, or you can drop them in soapy water. Some people don't like to kill them. They do turn into a beautiful, I think it's called the Sphinx butterfly. So if you prefer to relocate them, you can certainly welcome to do that, whichever you feel more comfortable with. Whatever you do though, get them off your tomatoes because they will quickly destroy your tomato plant. So good luck to you. Hopefully you're not gonna have any huge issues with that this summer. It's kind of crazy. Some summers I've had a ton. This summer is kind of a moderate amount. I've maybe pulled off 10. And some I don't have any. So just keep an eye out for them and hope won't come in your garden too terribly often. Okay, Jan, how's it going? You need to make your pepper jelly. Yeah, I haven't made it actually for a little while. I'm trying to grow hot peppers. Only lucky with the Hawaiian chili peppers. Hope to harvest my watermelon soon. Three racing to the finish, I love that. I am so happy that your watermelons are almost ready to harvest. They are so rewarding to grow. I mean, I think there's nothing like picking a watermelon on a hot day, sticking it in the fridge and cold and juicy later on that day, and you can have a bite of your own. Knowing that you grew it yourself is so much fun. So good luck with those hot peppers too, Jan. And if I get enough hot peppers this year, although I don't tend to grow as many as I used to, I will definitely make some jelly. PB and Jelly, great to have you on here. Speaking of jelly, I'm currently not harvesting much, but I watched Kim's last video about crops to plant in July and August and look forward to a late summer crop. Thank you so much for doing that. That's awesome. You're going to absolutely love it. And thank you for mentioning that video. Posted that on Friday. And you guys, if you haven't watched it, you got to go back and watch it, because if you think it's too late to plant something, it's not. Plant the crops I mentioned in that video. And my late summer garden seed collection is especially designed for quick growing, easy to grow, quick growing, quick mature vegetables. And that way, you know, you can plant these now and they'll be ready to harvest in about 6 to 8 weeks. So in the late summer, you're still going to be getting harvest. Sometimes what happens is, we've talked about this a couple of times on the live streams, is that your plants that you planted first thing in the spring, like this tomato back here, they start to kind of get beat up by the weather, by bugs, by critters, whatever it is. And southern climate, you can grow a lot of these into the late fall, November, December, because it's still warm here. If you're in a climate where it starts to get cool in September, you should be able to get harvest on these, and they're going to grow really well, fresh new plants, and they won't struggle near as much as original plants that you got in your garden in the spring. So grab one of these. Today is the last day of the MAC sale. If you don't know about that, it's 25% off with code MAC, which some of you know is our faithful garden dog, applies to all seed collections, but the late summer one and the heat tolerant. And also, believe it or not, you guys, fall garden is just around the corner. So it'd be a great time to grab your fall garden seed collection. I forget how many varieties in there. I want to say 15 cool other veggies. So to use the 25% off with the mat, and a couple little fun things you're going to get with the sale ends tonight is get a, first of all, a postcard from my new book, but a free red burgundy bush bean seed collection. So these go fast. Beautiful purple beans, but the cool thing is you're also going to get a sticker. We're actually out of the stickers. We had so many orders over the weekend, but now magnets. We might have a few stickers left that we're going to throw in a magnet or a sticker of MAC. So this is kind of a fun little freebie for the month. So grab your seed collections and your books, your smart pots. Good time to grab my new book or my Organic Gardening for Everyone or my new one on raised bed gardening with the code MAC over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. Okay, so let's see what's going on in the chat here. And then we'll go back to our second what to do in July. More question from PB&J. I was one 3-gallon bucket is big enough for one tiny Tim plant. You know what? You could try it. I just put them in my 5-gallon smart pots here, but give a 3-gallon bucket a try. But the 5-gallon is just the perfect size for one plant. I usually put a small little tomato cage in. And this one back here has tons of tomatoes on it. And I've got a new fresh round going down below about 5 or 6 months. So I'm going to have a ton of little tiny Tims later in the summer. And the tiny Tims, I have had some questions about this. The tiny Tims are in my late summer garden seed collection, the continued garden seed collection. You can grab it in the 5-gallon smart pots. By the one with the seeds, it has 3 seed packets in it, 1 tiny packet, a lettuce packet, and a basil packet. So find it on my website. We'll be working on our next couple of months, making my website a little bit more easy to find things because it's a little hard. So, but go in there, grab those seed collections, and you should be good to go. Okay, so let's move on to number 2. That actually leads us to number 2, and that is don't stop planting. Okay, don't stop planting. I think the most frequent question I get is it too late to plant, and then fill in the blank. Don't start planting. And again, at this time of the year, it might be a little late to start large size tomatoes from seed or peppers from seed for a lot of people, especially if you live in a northern climate where you get earlier fall weather, earlier cooler weather. But you can plant a lot of vegetables right now. And my 3 favorites that grow super quick that I recommend everyone plant this time of the year are beans, cucumbers, and squash. Those are fast. You're going to get harvest in 6 to 8 weeks or sooner. The temperature is so warm right now. They really grow fast. They germinate quickly. They grow quickly in containers. You don't even have to start them indoors. You can start them in flats right outside on your deck or patio if you don't have room in your garden yet. Or you can pop seeds right in your garden beds or containers. So do make sure you go back and watch our weekend video on that. All the details are there. But I want everyone this week to plant 1 or 2 of those vegetables. Because believe me, come late August, early September, you're going to be so glad that you did. Because you're going to have a fresh new wave of veggies when you're pulling a lot of your other veggies out. Or maybe they're just dying off due to the end of their life. Pests, critters, disease, whatever the case might be. So you always want to have backup veggies growing. You always want to have a second round in the last summer, in the late summer, because you get to August and you have nothing to harvest. You're going to be really sad and you're going to really miss those cucumbers and beans and squash. But Tiny Tim's one of my favorite little tips. You can definitely start those now. And I, someone just asked, can you plant them in a 3-gallon? Yes, they would probably okay, 3-gallon, they're going to do probably better with more tomatoes in a 5-gallon. And on the video we posted on Friday, we planted 3 plants in a Cali Kim 10-gallon. So all kinds of options over on my website to help you out with that. 5 gallons, the 10 gallons, the little shorty raised beds work great for tiny Tim or for your some garden. You can grab a little shorty, pop that up. That way you don't have to worry about waiting for your garden beds to get emptied out or for things to die off. So those little shorties are a 3-foot raised bed, which are really, really nice. And I saw someone ask, what's the difference between your smart pots and the ones that are sold on Amazon? The smart pots are especially designed for growing vegetables. It's the only, as far as I know, the only pot out there on the market that's completely, only other fabric pot out there on the market that's completely organic, especially designed for growing vegetables. So it's a proprietary fabric that Pots developed. It has it has holes in it, teeny tiny holes. It's aerated, which means that the roots don't get root bound. So the person who asked me, can you grow them in a 5-gallon bucket? You can, but hard-sided plastic containers don't breathe. The vegetables get hotter. The plants tend to get root bound, so you have to continually transplant. Smart pots don't do that. The fabric lasts for up to 5 to 8 years or even longer. And the roots, what they do is called air pruning. So they have a nice fibrous root mass. So they can still take up the water and nutrients. So it's one reason we can grow larger vegetables in smaller size smart pots is because the roots are still healthy and don't get considered like in a smaller pot. And the fabric is much thicker and more durable than the things that you'll find on Amazon. So that's my 2 cents there. I've worked with smarts for 6 or 8 years. Everything's manufactured in Oklahoma City, completely 100% USA made. Great people, family-owned business, and I stand fully behind them. I absolutely love them. And I will never use another type of fabric container. It's really an amazing container. So the Calicum Smart Pots you can grab over on my website, but they have lots of other sizes at smartpots.com. And you can use the Calicum over there for 10% off anything on their website. Okay, so let's jump into the chat here and see what other questions we have. Coming on, Guadalupe, great to see you on here today. Hi everyone, the garden is going great. Harvest tomatoes, cute zucchini, squash, kohlrabi, red cabbage. Planted your seeds. Thank you so much for with my seeds. For a second wave, cukes, zooks, squash, you're the best. Wow, Guadalupe, you just made my day. That's awesome. I'm so glad to hear you're enjoying your garden. This is the most important thing. Get out and have fun. Enjoy your garden. Don't get stressed if things die or don't do well. I know that that's disappointing, but it's all about just having a good time out the garden. So get there and just do it. Okay, next tip here on what to do in July. Excuse me, and that is man disease and pests. Now, a lot of times this is the pests start coming in. Now, Cliff was just saying, and I have to concur with him, I don't know if we should say this or not, fingers crossed, but so far I've had very little issues with pests or disease yet this summer. And I think a lot of it is due to building my soil up for several years with the Vermistera product Vitality. The worm castings are just amazing for long-term health benefits in the soil and the worm tea. Now, you guys always hear me say in the videos that the worm tea, the worm castings, and the Vitality, which is like a worm casting supercharged type of liquid fertilizer, give your soil and your plants tons of beneficial bacteria. I think I say that every time I use it. It's true though, it does. It helps your soil and your plants be healthier, so you're not struggling as much with pests and disease. And I've really seen that this year. I do have some things going on, some spider mites, some things like that, but honestly I haven't sprayed my garden. Maybe one plant I did spray for a spider mites, but for the most part I haven't had to spray much at all. But if you don't have that health built up in your soil over the years, or things just happen sometimes, things come in and just wipe out plants, things in my garden too. You know, just now's the time to really start managing that. So keep an eye on your garden. Go around your garden, maybe you're wandering around daily just to have fun, but also be checking for any issues that come up. Like the tomato hornworm came up last week in my garden. If I wouldn't have been checking for those, I wouldn't have seen those, so I wouldn't have been able to pull them off and they would have come through and really done a lot of damage. So do get out there and check before you have big issues. And that way, if you have an issue, you can get out there and take care of it before it gets out of hand. So some things to use if you're having problems with pests are the neem oil, peppermint oil, rosemary oil combination. I've got a video on organic pest control. I also use a lot of Bonide products. They're very fast acting. They have a great organic line. You can check that out at nide.com. They're in subtle super soap I particularly like for controlling spider mites and powdery mildew. They do have a lot of really great organic options. Those are some great ones to do. The powdery mildew is, you can also help control with a milk water spray. And I've got a video, you can check that out. And the ratio is approximately 8 to 10 parts water. I've used 8, 9, and 10 parts. It doesn't really matter. 8 parts water to 1 part milk. People say, can you use skim milk? Can you use whole milk? It doesn't really matter as long as you use a type of milk that has protein, whether it's almond milk. I've never actually tried it with almond milk. I've only done cow's milk, so that's what's worked for me. But give it a go, and you do want to spray it in direct sunlight. There's something about that that helps counteract powdery mildew. And then, you know, remove, I always remove any affected leaves, because usually the powdery mildew is a really big issue for most people right about now. And then go ahead and spray your plant down with that milk spray or an organic, some kind of other type of organic spray. So, oh, and then the heat. I wanted to mention heat too. Of course, we're all dealing with heat, right? Summer. You guys know what I'm going to say. Shade cloth. Yep, shade cloth, okay? This will save your garden. This is a 40% weave. I also use a 60% weave that has proteins in it, Alina. It's the protein in the milk that counteracts with the sunlight or reacts with the sunlight and provides some type of disinfecting effect on the powdery mildew. What was I saying? Shade cloth. I do have links in the video description for shade cloth. However, be aware that Amazon changes products out frequently. I know Nisha had an issue lately with getting some shade cloth that wasn't that great. So, you know, do check that out. You can check out your local garden center for shade cloth. It really helps when the temps get over 90, the flowers dry up, drop off, and then you kind of have to start all over again. And it kind of just slows you down. So use shade cloth in the heat and get out there and water your garden and make sure it's nice and watered deeply so that you're getting nice deep water right to the roots. And of course, drip irrigation is a lifesaver with me, especially in the heat. You may need to get out there and adjust your water schedule just a bit. Temps in the 90s into the 100s, you really want to pay attention to that, especially your containers and your hanging baskets. You might have to water twice a day. Okay, so thing to do in July, enjoy the second time to here is don't stop planting. Refresh if you're getting buffering or audio. We do the best we can on the videos, but sometimes things happen. Okay, and the third tip is to manage disease and heat damage. And you want to, another little thing here I meant to mention is when you see any issues with plants, like yellowing leaves, tomatoes tend to yellow from the bottom up. Make sure that you're taking those leaves immediately so things aren't spreading. So that would include powdery mildew type leaves, any yellowing leaves on your tomatoes, any spotted leaves. Go ahead and just take those off to keep your plants healthier. Okay, so let's jump back into the chat here. Oh no, I was gonna just say the next one. We're moving on to number 4, which is watering, which I kind of already mentioned a little bit. So I guess we've kind of covered tip number 4. So watering, make sure your plants again are deeply watered. If you don't have drip installed and somewhere where it doesn't rain like we do here in California, make sure that if you can at all possible, install drip in your containers and raised beds. Easy to install. I have a ton of videos on that. Go back and check that out. But believe me, it will save your plants, especially in the summer heat. Not to mention you're going to save water, you're going to save a ton of time, and it just keeps your plants evenly moist. Containers especially will need watering more often in the heat. So if that's something that interests you, go back and watch the videos on install drip. The other thing you want to be doing about now is to go around and give your plants kind of a midsummer boost. I like to do that mid-season. And what you can do is you can just, if you have compost or if you have wastings and or granular fertilizer, any of those three, you want to go in your garden and just apply a handful at the base of your plants or sprinkle some in your container and kind of just scratch it into the soil. That's a nice long release fertilizer. It'll continue to feed your plant out over the next couple of months. And sometimes we've done maybe pruning. Yeah, thank you. That's funny, Ruth. a happy cosmos waving behind little breeze here. So in the midsummer, you know, the plants might get a little tired out. Maybe you've done some pruning. Maybe you've done some harvesting and your plant just kind of needs a little bit of an oomph. So you can provide that with a mid boost and you may very well get extra harvest or an additional harvest out of your plants. So do that first thing I mentioned, the organic fertilizer, the compost, the worm castings, put that around plants. And then I also like to give them a liquid boost of something that will immediately be available. So the water available fertilizer, the plants can immediately take up the nutrients. And I mix little cocktails in my watering can. I've read it in my book, Raised Gardening. I have my whole fertilizer schedule that I do in here that I suggest and recommend along the different items that I use. But typically what I'll do for a mid-season boost is I'll do either the Vermistera Vitality or the Worm Tea, which I absolutely love. And I saw someone ask earlier, how often can you water with the Worm Tea? And it's a really slow and steady fertilizer. It doesn't have a high boost of nitrogen or anything. So you can even water your container plants with it like once a week, or your garden beds with it once a week, but even more often than that if you want to. So in my little plant cocktail, I'll put either the Vermistera Vitality or the Worm Tea or both. Sometimes I'll do the fish fertilizer if I've done a heavy pruning, or if I'm giving a little boost to some lettuce plants, or lettuce in the summer, I can't grow lettuce here, it's too hot. Some leafy greens or herbs that I want a nice good boost of leafy growth, I'll use the fish fertilizer or the good dirt plant food because it's higher in nitrogen. And that's gonna really help my my plants into production. I typically don't use a higher nitrogen fertilizer for plants like my tomatoes here are fruiting. I don't want more green leafy growth. I really want more tomato plants. So I will, what I'll do is I'll add some liquid fertilizer into the watering can that maybe has a higher P and a K, the second two numbers. You know, N, which is the nitrogen, the P is the phosphorus, the K is the potassium. So a higher P and K number will help encourage flowering and fruiting and help the overall health of your plant. So go to your garden center and look for an organic fertilizer that has a higher the two number. It's like the third number, if that makes sense. And that will help encourage flowering and fruiting on your plant. So definitely pay attention to the watering and the mid-season boost in July. Really important to do that, and that way you'll get more harvest in the summertime. Okay, let's see what questions we have in the chat here. And we'll move on to our next tip. Okay, Ruth Ann, great tip here. I consider my worm castings and tea as soil nutrition. Yes, they are. They do help your soil be healthy. And I had mentioned that earlier as my soil has gotten healthier over the years that I've been using worm castings and worm tea. I've probably been using it now maybe for 5 years, I want to guess. And each year I see a little bit less pests and disease. But again, if you do have pests and disease, it's not your fault. It just happens sometimes, but the healthier the soil, the healthier the plants overall, the less pests and disease that you'll have. Okay, I did container gardening and it grew about flowers, but not any produce. I'm in Central California where it's super hot, especially this week with 100 plus degrees. Judy, that can be so frustrating when you're really working hard at your garden and that happens. I would highly suggest using shade cloth, especially in 100 plus degree temperatures. You may want to just keep the shade cloth up all summer. I know it doesn't look pretty. I prefer not to have the shade cloth up, but I also prefer to have some vegetables growing. But it literally can keep your plants at 10 to 15 degrees cooler under the shade cloth. So what happens when your plants get over 90? They're stressed out. They're acting to, they're just trying to stay alive. They're typically not gonna be growing a ton. You might see tons of blossom drop and drying up, and you're gonna have to give them some type of protection if you, to help maximize the growth and production of your plant. So I actually have several videos on heat wave gardening. So just look up heat wave on my channel. Pull up some videos to see like how to cover your plants with it and how to kind of react, what to do during a heat. Okay, let me, I've got my pepper tomato shade cloth, but it just didn't seem to help the green beans or cukes. Okay, you may want to just start with a new round. Those may have gotten too hot. They don't always do super well in really hot temperatures. You may want to plant some more. Maybe pop up like one of my little shorties or one of my smart pots raised bed, or if you have containers already, put them in an area that gets morning sun and the afternoon shade. You might have better luck with that. But yeah, it can be discouraging when the heat just kind of burns your vegetables up. But again, make sure they're well watered and do the best you can to get some type of shade. But start over fresh. You'll have probably better luck with plants that aren't already spilling. Okay, I have, this is from Wanda. Yeah, it's been absolutely brutal, right, Rachel? I have noticed a lot of birds in the garden. I know they are pecking holes in my tomato. Maybe they got my cucumbers too. That could very well be. One thing you can do about that that does help is either cover with shade cloth, which helps keep them away, but also provide some water for the birds to drink, maybe a bird bath. Even just a little tray of water outside will be helpful, because many times they are just looking for hydration. So if you do that, it'll give them a source that they can drink from, and hopefully it'll leave your tomatoes alone, or at least it might help kind of mitigate that problem. Okay, so let's talk about a bonus tip today. And I had four tips prepared, and I'm like, hey, you know what? We can't end our live stream today talking about, to me, the most important thing about gardening is having vegetables. The food is just one of the small rewards of it. But one of my favorite things is just creating a fun space to enjoy in the garden. And you guys probably saw all of our videos we did on the new chill zone we created. We just absolutely love it. I cannot even tell you how many enjoyable evenings we have spent down in our chill zone. With the new raised bed, we installed like a little fire pit down there, some new like decking, and then the solar lights just kind of topped it off. So if at all possible, even if it's a small little space, create a chill zone in your garden. I don't care what it is. Maybe it's a chair, a special chair by one of your favorite plants with a spot to put your favorite fridge. But create a fun space in your garden, because it's for your mind, it's good for your body, it's good for your soul. It's so enjoyable to go down to the garden, the lower part of the garden, to relax every evening and look up, see the beauty that you've created all around you. I mean, we work hard in our gardens, right? We worked very hard building that raised bed and putting the plants in. I know you guys do too, and I want to commend you for that. But take the time to relax and enjoy your handiwork. Enjoy God's creation all around you. In the evenings, it's cooler. We sit down there, you guys, and watch the birds, watch the sunset. There's just so much life going on. The butterflies and the bees aren't really out at night, but in the morning, sometimes if we're walking with our coffee, you see just life all around you. So it's just mentally refreshing, and it makes a really nice kind of close evening. We don't always eat our dinner down there, but a lot of times we'll just go down there at night for 10 or 15 minutes, turn the fire on. We're loving those solar lights, you guys. And by the way, don't forget, those are by Hoselink. Those are a brand new thing that Hoselink came at, and they are amazing solar lights. We've had tons of solar lights over the years, and these are by far our favorite. And don't forget that discount you can get on the solar lights over at hoselink.com. Use the code CALILIGHT if you want to pop some garden. They have all kinds of different really fun solar lights you can use. You can purchase over there. Use the code CALILIGHTS for 10% off, and that goes all the way through July 31st. So they don't just make those reels, they make those beautiful lights as well. So let me know in the chat what type of chill zone you've created for yourself in your garden and what you like to do to relax in your garden. But I really think that's one of the most important things about gardening, is really, really enjoying it. And Cliff, yeah, you have an amazing garden, so you do need a sitting area. I know it's a lot of work to take care of a garden the size that you have, but let's create one you and your wife can go and sit in every evening for just a little bit. It doesn't have to be a long time, so you can look around and really, really enjoy it. Okay, Luz, I love video chatting from my garden. I share the garden with my family that way. That's a great idea. You can like FaceTime or Skype your family down there. And they don't have a garden, they might get excited about planting something, or they will enjoy your garden with you. It's really fun to enjoy your garden with people that you love. We had some friends over a few weeks ago, over the 4th of July, we had a little garden party, two other couples, and it was so much fun to take them through the garden. And they don't get in, so we're really enjoying seeing the different vegetables, how things grow. And I had a great time just, you know, showing them around. So it was really, really a lot of fun to do with people that we love. Okay, let's see if there's any other questions in the chat before we sign off for the day. Guadalupe, I watched your solar light video and ordered them. They're awesome. I love the difference it makes in my chill zone. Couldn't agree with you more. I'm really glad that you have them in your garden too. They are just so relaxing. Something about seeing that soft light come on as soon as the sun set, that really just, we always like, oh, solar lights came on. We run out to look at them if we're not already outside. So I'm glad you're enjoying them too. Okay, Judy, I love my solar lights, but I'm on a strict budget, so I bought them from the Dollar Tree. That's great too. I'm glad that you're enjoying them. They add such an ambiance, and not to mention, you don't have to spend any money on you're using solar lights. So much fun. Okay, Purnima, I have many flowers on tomatoes and zucchini, but not many fruits. Please tell me what I should do. Okay, you're gonna wanna try hand pollinating, okay? Tomatoes are super easy to hand pollinate because their flowers are self-pollinate. They have both male and female parts. So with tomatoes, to get more flowers, all you have to do is go and shake your tomato plants, and that will help pollinate your tomatoes. For zucchini, you're gonna wanna hand pollinate. So go to my Instagram, calicup29. I did a video a couple of weeks ago on hand pollinating zucchini. You'll see that you basically need to have a male and a female flower and take the pollen from the male flower with a little paintbrush and transfer it to the pollen on a female flower. The female flower will have a fruit attached to it. The male flower just has a stem. But go back and watch my Instagram video, all the details on that. And you may have to do that a couple of mornings to see if it's successful. You want to do it in the morning. That's when the flowers are open and when you're going to have the best success. Okay, let's see any more questions. Ruth Ann, you had a pepper question up earlier. If you could maybe state that again so I can see that. Mary Ram, some really pretty solar moths, but I was wondering if they bring in moths. We have a huge moth problem here. So I haven't really noticed that. So it really just depends on how active the moths are in your area. They're not super, I mean, they're bright for solar lights, but they're like a bright spotlight that you would have maybe like as a secure light or something like that. They just add more ambiance and ambient lighting, or ambient, I guess that's how you say it, to your garden. So you just kind of have to try it out for yourself and see how that works. Okay, Jan, still working on a chill spot. Right now I use the edge of my raised beds to watch the cat strolling the house, but likes her afternoon stroll. That's great too. That's the wonderful thing about raised beds is you can sit on them. So that's a perfect chill spot. So Jan, I'm really glad that you are finding a chill spot in your garden too. Okay, let's see any other questions here. Oh yeah, Nisha, I did see that weed puller that Hoselink came out with too, so no bending down. That is a handy little tool. I don't have that, but I saw that on their website. If you have a lot of weeds, that's definitely a super handy tool to use there. Okay, let's see if there's any other questions before we sign off for the day, Christina. Great. Is it too late to plant flowers? Absolutely not. Go back and watch our video we posted over the weekend. My favorite flowers that you can grow all summer long, so easy to grow, definitely not too late to plant them, are zinnias, sunflowers. Zinnias grow very quickly. I just planted a brand new wave of zinnias. I've just planted them in little pack flats right over, just sat them right on the deck over here. That way, when some of my zinnias are dying off, I'll have brand new ones to stick in or to put in different little holes in the garden that I want some extra color. So definitely not too late. So I have a zinnia seed collection and a flower seed collection. Thank you. Marigolds are great ones to plant too right now. They also grow from seed, or you can grab those in six packs at the garden center. But grab my sunflower seed collection, five varieties in here. The zinnia seed collection has some gorgeous variety. And then the late summer garden seed collection has one variety of zinnias in there. So you can grab any of those. Don't forget, 20% off sale, use the code MAC. You're gonna get the free bean seeds and a MAC sticker when you grab those. So guys, this has been so much fun. What a great group today. Really thank you for joining me. Back next Monday at noon Pacific time with a video or two in between. I hope you guys have an amazing week. Stay cool and make sure you get out and enjoy your garden. All right, everyone, happy Monday. Have a great week.